In November of 1982, 17 of the top video game players in North America gathered together in the middle of Main Street in Ottumwa, Iowa. They came to be photographed by Life magazine. And this is the story of this iconic image and the events that surrounded it.
Go, smile, ready, good, grin.
Enrico Ferrarelli is one of the better and most well-known photographers in the world, and he's photographed for Life magazine and done many Time magazine covers, and he's done corporate photography and has traveled to probably all continents doing photography on assignment, I mean, not on his own vacations. He's an excellent, consistently excellent photographer.
What's your capacity here? What are you doing?
Well, I'm a reporter. And in this situation, it's more than anything more like being a television producer than a print reporter. Because basically what I had to do was maybe be a liaison with Walter, get the people here, set this up, make sure everything would go right and get it together. My function. I have a function if it works out. I don't have a function if it didn't. I had a charade, but I'm sure it'll work out. So my function was just making sure that everything we did here would be produced as we intended to have it in the beginning.
In the street, well, we have to tell a story. I mean, what is the story? I mean, these people are really the best players. If you consider the picture as a piece of real estate, the fact of the best players takes, say, about 40% of the image. Then another 20% is the machines in which they play. You got to see what they're playing. Then you want to see that it happens in Ottumwa. And so the town gets another chunk of space. Then you got to leave some space free for the title of the picture, the caption or whatever. And so you group all these elements together. Then why put it in the street is because really arcades are like dark holes all the time, and they don't lend themselves to great images. And
okay, put the other chairs behind, close to the tall stools so you can stand up on them. Okay. In a few seconds, you can get the sun guy over
there. Okay, Drew. How was your assignment brought about, and maybe you could tell us a little bit about when you had the idea and then later on you picked up on it?
Well, it was a process. First idea for a video game story was probably in February, and then we tried to produce one that was different than had been done in Time magazine and probably People magazine and some other magazines, and we really couldn't do it and figure out a good way to do it, and we weren't going to waste 8 pages on a story that had been done before. And for the past 9 months, the idea of a video game story was still very much in the editor's mind. And if we couldn't have a feature story on it, it would make sense to have it in the year-end issue. And that's what this is for.
How about if you're all down in this kind of kneeling down at in front below the machines? Line up in front.
Ready. Ready.
Ready. Okay, look up. And you. What can you do from that position? What can you do? Like wave or?
Wave.
How about with the two pompons up like this? Okay. Look up, look up. Oh God, I see those wires. They're awful. Awful wires. I don't know where we could put those. Where could we put those wires?
Well, obviously, Walter Day has a knack for getting the word out about what he's involved in. And probably most arcades don't have someone who's that attuned to promoting what they're doing. Probably most don't go beyond, we should get out of the way a little here. Most go beyond what they're doing just in terms of a business or a local business. And I don't know, he had a good idea, which was to keep track of high score video champions. And it was something, if other people had done it, he did it better. So that's why he got himself better known. He had a good idea. That usually gets people better known than people with bad and old ideas.
Well, it's a lot of fun having the most famous arcade in the world because, of course, we get lots of attention. In fact, far more attention than any other arcade in the world gets. In fact, we've even been in the newspaper in China. We were in the Taiwan Post. I think it's technically called the Chinese Post in Taiwan in the early part of October of 82. We've been in so many magazines that we can't keep track of them, and quite often we find out that we're generally in a newspaper story or a magazine story or a radio interview almost every single day. It would seem that it's a fact that every day we are covered in the news someplace. Welcome to Video Game News Update. I'm Walter Day at the Galaxies International Scoreboard. Imagine playing a video game for 36 and a half hours in one quarter. That's how Leo Daniels of North Carolina earned a world record score of 169 million points on Robotron. Leo, it's nice to have you here at Twin Galaxies. While you're here, we want you to take a look at the Tempest machine and show us your style that you used to reach 3 million. Because as everybody knows, you're the world champion, and nobody else has ever passed the 99th level. Let's see what your style is, how you got up there, okay?
I never really got that high on Donkey Kong, but Steve Sanders saw the score that I got, and he started going for the record on Donkey Kong, which he has set it way out of reach, which is something I like to do too when I set a record.
Well, we're here with Mark Robichek today, who is considered by many video game players to be one of the finest game players himself in America. He has the uncanny ability to solve maze-type video games to a degree that other people seem not to be able to reach. Now, Mark, why don't you tell us a little bit about your philosophy behind playing maze-type games?
Okay, well, first of all, it involves a lot of time, and particularly patience, where you learn a game, develop a pattern, and use it repetitively when you find something that works.
Now, as it stands right now, you're the world champion on Frogger, which is a maze game because it's an obstacle course going through a maze of different moving objects. And also, you're one of the world champions on Berserk. You're the world champion on the Slow Bullets variation of the Berserk game. And you're the world champion on Tutankham, which we're here with right now and which you can demonstrate.
I think Twin Galaxies has really changed drastically the idea of getting high scores on video games. Before, people say, oh, I've got the world's record on Pac-Man, or I have the record on this, but they never really knew. Now Twin Galaxies has kind of set a pace and set a standard. I mean, if you want to know the world's record, all you have to do is call, you know, Otemwa Iowa, Walter Day, and he can tell you the record.
Send your playing techniques or high scores to the International Scoreboard in Otemwa. Join us again for Video Game News Update. I'm Walter Day at the Twin Galaxies International Scoreboard.
My name is Mike Lipkowski. I'm 14 from Spring, Texas. I go to Spring High School. I'm in the ninth grade.
Explain why you came to Twin Galaxies. You came as the champ on Centipede, right? Tell us about that.
Well, about a week before this was all to happen, I decided I was going to break the record on Centipede because I wanted to be here and have the record while I was here. So 25 million and one.
Should I stretch it out like this?
Sure, it says number one world champion, and part of the whole video game scene, the hoopla around it, the t-shirt is a big part of it. If you don't have a t-shirt, you're nobody. Your t-shirt's got to be original, it's got to be authentic, and it's got to, you know, have your own personal theme, you know.
And when am I going to run out of bullshit? There we go, one more. All right, there, it's a great thing.
My name is Lewis Wilson, and for the last 5 days, I've been the camera person, videographer for this documentary that we've been doing on Twin Galaxies, the most famous video arcade in the world. And we've documented this visit from Canada and the United States of video game champions who have come here this weekend to compete with each other and compare notes. And also this weekend, of course, there was a visit from Life magazine. They sent a famous photographer here to photograph some of the champions. And this is what we came to investigate through a sort of cinema verite style.
So Life published these photos as a two-page spread in their January Year in Pictures edition. But something even larger happened at Twin Galaxies that month. The number one TV show in the nation came to Twin Galaxies to cover a special event. You'll see a lot of people wearing referee shirts in the following sequences because that event was the first ever North American Video Game Olympics.
All these players will be on, that's incredible. Half the show at least will be the footage from the filming here, and then about 5 minutes of the show will be the final countdown amongst the three players in the studios in LA and Hollywood.
I don't know, it's pretty weird because Atomo doesn't seem like a very big town, but now it is.
It's pretty amazing having these kids here. You go to each machine and every kid is almost a record holder in a certain category. In keeping the scores for this weekend, the lineup of the scores have changed with every game, because in every game there's been one kid who's been, you know, better than the rest of the crowd. So we're coming into the last game and we still have no idea who the winner is going to be.
As far as the mayor's office goes, we make declarations from time to time, and normally they are something that's already established, like National Blood Donor Month or National Public Safety Week, things like that. But in this situation, nobody had proclaimed themselves the video game capital of the world, and really it turned out to be a situation where I proclaimed Atomo the video game capital of the world, and we just challenge anybody to prove that we're wrong. And I think the fact that we're hosting the first North American Video Game Olympics gives some credibility to the fact that, you know, we are recognized as that now.
I think, now this is my own opinion, but from observing the children who are here, I get the feeling that they might be a little notch above as far as intelligence. They've got to have a lot of determination too, but there's just that perseverance, you know, to carry through hour after hour after hour in those games, that they've got to, unless they can get a pattern. If they've got a pattern, then it's just a repetitious thing that I think anyone can do. But in order to reach that pattern, they've got to be intelligent enough to figure it out. And I think these are pretty intelligent boys who are here. I'm just sorry there are no girls here.
Explain why you came to Twin Galaxies. You came as the champ on Centipede, right? Tell us about that.
Well, about a week before this was all to happen, I decided I was going to break the record on Centipede because I wanted to be here and have the record while I was here. So I just started Friday night, and Sunday I finished. I played 47 hours, and I guess that's why you picked me to be here.
So explain how long that was. That's the longest time ever done a centipede. Tell us about that.
Yeah, that's the next longest is Darren himself. He played for 15 million, which is probably about 30 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to try and double it at 30 million, but fatigue was just setting in, and I just couldn't do it. I had to stop at 25 million and one. I figured I'd get one. That way I can always say I went over 25 million.
What are your feelings about video game players after meeting these 16 players?
Okay.
Well, they're obviously very proficient in what they do, and it's interesting that they're sort of in their own minds and probably in the minds of their peers. I mean, athletes of sorts in terms of the dedication they put into it and that stuff. It's not something that, I'm impressed. I'm not much of a video game player, and it's not something I'm going to take much time to do, but they obviously have learned what's inside those things much more than anybody else, and got to be impressed with their dedication, if nothing else.
We have a spot, or many spots, that when you hit the monster's coming down and you're going up, and at the time that you hit, you pop through it. All right, the reason for that is the computer is drawing Pac-Man and drawing the monster on the screen. It takes it off, draws it right next to it, takes it off, draws it right next to it. And what happens is they hit at a certain time when they're both off, and you would just pop right through it. It's totally amazing.
We're going to write a whole series of books, in fact, on the
on games that require patterns or predetermined courses, not on reflexive games. And the Pac-Man book is really interesting. I really love it. We can go right through monsters.
And two of us got together and we said, well, let's do something. Let's write a book on this. And, you know, I took it then as a joke. I said, yeah, sure, right. But then as we started getting the patterns together and the ideas, and we started discovering so many things about the game, we were just so, you know, psyched up about it. So we decided to write the book.
And we're going to go right through monsters, which everybody, I don't know anybody else who can go right through monsters.
Unlike most people who have heard about Twin Galaxies either in a magazine or on the radio, I heard about it when I was writing a book called The Video Master's Guide to Donkey Kong. My editor at Bantam Books told me to call Walter Day.
I attended my freshman year in Kirksville, Missouri, and Walter Day also has the Twin Galaxies there. And at the time I was going to school, it was right when he came up with the idea of starting an international scoreboard. So I just played in his arcade, and when I got high scores, he'd watch me. And for his grand opening, he arranged for a TV spot to be done with me breaking the national high score on Space Invaders Deluxe. And just all year long, I reported scores that way. And then when I went back to Montana, he made me I think he called it a correspondent, where I can watch other people play and report their high scores. It's just, it's nice to feel that you're the best at something, you know. I may never be the best at anything else in the world, and I might, but I know right now I'm the best in the world at four different games. It's just a nice feeling.
Fantasies are fulfilled in Twin Galaxies just as well as fantasies are fulfilled in any theater house. You can see realities that are not part of your daily life on the screen in the theater house and on the screen in Twin Galaxies. So
I hope in the near future to be one of the very top players between first and third for video games. I'm going to keep playing and playing until I have at least 10 or more world records.
Just, I don't know if I do very good, but I just like to play them for the fun.
He wanted to find out if any of those were national records, and no one really kept any records, so he started the Twin Galaxies scoreboard, which I think is really, it's really fantastic for the players who can really master the games. It gives them a chance to, for some other people to see the masters play and learn tips and stuff like this gathering we have now. It really gives them a chance, other people a chance to watch us play, and it gives the players who've worked so hard and played so many games, wasted so much money, it gives them a chance to show off, you know, show their talent.
And Walter's valued as a keeper of standards and an arbiter and a rule maker in terms of video game competitions. So it's largely due to Walter Day that Twin Galaxies has gained the fame, really.
Ever since the article, I guess I've, you know, my parents bought me lots of issues, you know, about 20 issues, and all my relatives and, you know, my friends have, you know, said, oh, wow, you're a star now.
Todd has fallen even farther behind, and he takes this thing from the spider.
With less than 15,000 points to go for the goal of 90,000, Ben demonstrates the extraordinary marksmanship that has put him in the lead.
Todd's still in there fighting. He gets an inch more, but then his nemesis, the spider, strikes again. It is less than 1,500 points left to go. He blasts the millipede, then a spider to put him over the top and on the donkey.
Todd has more than 30,000 points left to score, but he seems undaunted as he takes on a swarm of dragonflies.
Aaron keeps playing strongly and consistently. He shoots a card of millipede to...
There's more than that, there's a whole bunch of
Where do we go from here? Well, obviously, Twin Galaxies is more than an arcade. In fact, it sometimes isn't even really an arcade. It's a media experience, a showcase where all the kids of the world get their opportunity to show off.
and you can be sure that there's going to be many more media events to come.
After That's Incredible, it wasn't long before the governor of Iowa, with many top game manufacturer executives, paid a special visit to honor Walter Day and the Twin Galaxies International Scoreboard. All of these events taken together, from the live photos to the video game Olympics to the visits by dignitaries and many other events, were like an explosion. Some have called it the Big Bang of organized video game playing. And if that is true, then the rumble of that explosion is still felt in this room today as this documentary comes to a close.